Okay, I think we could start. Thank you very much for everyone turning out. My role here is fairly brief, just to introduce the people who are going to do the introductions. And then you'll see me at the end as well. So to begin with, I'll just call on the president of Campion College to do a few introductions.
Thank you, Martin. Well, welcome to everyone this evening. And I'd just like to acknowledge that we are on Treaty 4 land and homeland of the Métis, a relationship that we value at Campion College and at the University of Regina. It's wonderful to be here tonight. We've had quite a few interesting lectures on campus this week and a few more to come. I realize this Thursday we will also have the debate and deliberation talk here as well. So lots of interesting discussions coming up. I'd like to recognize some very important people here. First of all, Dr. Vian Timmins, President of the University of Regina. And to thank Vian for an excellent working relationship with the Federated Colleges. We really appreciate that. And her husband, Stu, is here as well. Dr. Brian Hillis, President of Luther College, is here. And my counterpart, Dr. Allison Fizzard, the Dean of Campion College, is here tonight. And I thank Allison for taking the initiative in inviting Dr. Zinck here from Edmonton. It was Allison's idea, and I think it's a great idea, as you'll see tonight. So thank you, Allison. Also, we have Dr. Michael Boda here, who's the Chief Electoral Officer for the Province of Saskatchewan. Michael? And Mr. Curtis Kleisinger, who is the Executive Director of the Mother Teresa Middle School. Curtis? And we have a special relationship with that school as a Jesuit Academy, so thanks for being here, Curtis. Also, Dr. Rick Clear, Dean of Arts, is here. Rick, thank you. And Dr. Essam Hussein, Dean of Engineering, is also here with us this evening. And thanks to all of you for your support of the Federated Colleges and our relationship with the university, of preserving diversity within unity and making this college and the university the best it can be. We really appreciate that. At this point, I'd like to call up, bring back our MC, Martin, Dr. Martin Beach.
Luckily, it's brief from me. All I need to do at this stage of the game is to introduce Dr. Chris Ragel, who will introduce the speaker to us. Thank you.
Thank you, Martin. So it is it's my pleasure to offer up brief introductory remarks this evening as we welcome Dr. Arlette Zinck as this year's Distinguished Nash Lecturer. Dr. Zinck is Associate Professor of English at King's University in Edmonton, Alberta, and also Dean of Arts there. She received a PhD in 1993 from the University of Alberta, where we actually, in fact, crossed paths a few times as I was in the early years of my doctoral studies and she was in the completing years. Though I know she doesn't remember us encountering each other, I do remember that, actually, crossing paths in the hallways and so on. She trained as a John Bunyan scholar. Bunyan is probably best known as the author of the religious allegory, The Pilgrim's Progress, published in 1678, and is a staple in English literature classes. I certainly remember reading that book in one of my undergraduate classes several decades ago, and I partly remember it because I was maybe too young to be reading that book and appreciating its full value. One does not need to dig too deeply into Bunyan's history to learn that he suffered from religious persecution and was imprisoned for 12 years for his religious practices. While I could not even begin to venture to guess as to whether or not Dr. Zinck's scholarly pursuits have had any influence on her involvement with contemporary events, as a fellow scholar of English literature, I can state with certainty that the literary tradition is rich with texts that challenge us to think about society, justice, truth, ethics, and how we interact with our fellow humans. As Dr. Zinck has demonstrated, one can mine this tradition in the pursuit of post-secondary education that is humane, equitable, and inclusive. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Zinck.
Great pleasure to be here, so thank you for making the journey out this evening. Very cold evening it is. I want to begin with three questions. What do we need to know? What sort of discernment, what must we enact to make decisions that are not, quote, under the influence of any inordinate attachment, that allow us to follow a path toward the greater good? What does it mean to connect our thought and our action, our theory and our practice in a way that directs us into a life of ethical behavior that leads us toward justice? And finally, what does it mean to hope? These questions are, I believe, central to the mission of a liberal arts university. Our job in this branch of the academy is not only to train good employees, but also good citizens. These questions also animated St. Ignatius of Loyola and the spiritual tradition of the Jesuit order from which your community here at Campion College is formed. They are also questions that have preoccupied my colleagues and me over the last number of years. I come to you this evening as a neighbor to tell a story about a remarkable set of events. As I tell you what happened, I also want to share how those events have helped me to think about the questions that I have just outlined. As far as stories go, the one I have the privilege of sharing with you is a stunner. Strong plot, interesting characters, strange settings, and a whole lot of dramatic tension. This story has it all. So let me begin. It's hopeless. The speaker's thick Scottish brogue settled over the university's gymnasium like a dense Healand fog. I sat surrounded by 600 or so newly voting age Canadians, my students. The room was still. At the podium, the speaker had just spent an hour talking about his client, Canadian child soldier Omar Khadr. The speaker was Mr. Dennis Edney, QC, one of Canada's preeminent criminal defense attorneys. When he spoke in 2008, Mr. Edney had already volunteered years of his life to defend the only Canadian citizen held in Guantanamo Bay. As the word hopeless fell from his lips, my colleagues and I knew we were in trouble. The story he had just shared was hair-raising. Mr. Edney had been invited to campus as part of the King's University's biennial interdisciplinary studies conference. King's, like Campion, is a liberal arts university rooted in the Christian tradition. Each term, students and faculty at my home school cancel classes and invite speakers in to explore big ideas. The conference is designed to help our students to see how all they are learning in their university classroom is useful in the world beyond our doors. It is designed to help students think and to help them integrate this thought into a tradition of robustly Christian ethical thinking about the world, its problems, and their solutions. In September of 2008, the theme of the conference was invisible dignity, And our invited speakers were asked to help students understand how our inherent human dignity can often be obscured by poverty and structural injustice. Mr. Edney's plenary address had stirred something deep in our students. Let me share with you a few of its highlights. In the early morning of July 27, 2002, U.S. soldiers surrounded a dusty compound near Khost, Afghanistan. Four people were hiding inside. 30 or more U.S. servicemen were engaged in the battle. Before long, air support was called in, and soon the desert hideout was peppered with munitions, first by Apache attack helicopters, then by two A-10 Warthog fighter jets, and finally by two F-18s, which dropped 500-pound bombs on the compound. At the conclusion of the battle, five local Afghans were dead, and one U.S. soldier was mortally wounded. In the corner of the compound was 15-year-old Omar Khadr from Scarborough, Ontario. He was blinded in one eye, concussed, full of shrapnel, and he had two bullet holes in his back. How did Omar Khadr get into that mess, you might ask? Omar's father had been a fundraiser who for many years worked raising money for schools for girls and local hospitals in Afghanistan. Somewhere in the midst of these dealings, he became involved with Osama bin Laden. In the summer of 2002, Omar, a compliant teen, had gone where his father sent him and found himself in the middle of a war. When the firefight was over, U.S. forces treated Omar on the field and moved him to the military base at Bagram. He was accused of having thrown the grenade that eventually killed the American soldier, and he was taken into custody. In the following weeks, he was interrogated relentlessly by a man later tried and convicted for torturing another detainee to death. Mr. Edney told the group that the profoundly wounded teen with two golf ball-sized bullet holes in his chest had been named Buckshot by the guards because of the many shrapnel wounds in his body and made to carry heavy pails of water until those wounds wept. He was deprived of sleep, made to endure petty cruelties of cold temperatures, and eventually he was starved for 3 days, then loaded like freight onto an aircraft headed for the prison in Guantanamo Bay, Cuba. Edney told the students that despite all of this, and in the context of years of conversations, he had never once heard Omar Khadr speak a miserable word about anyone. In addition to these gruesome details, students were also told about the legal aspects of the case. Since our conference centered around the theme of invisible human dignity, students learned of the many ways in which Omar's treatment constituted abuses of the law made in the name of security. The legal tale was almost as distressing as the stories of physical and emotional abuse. There was no clear evidence to back the claim that Omar had thrown the grenade that eventually killed the American soldier. Field reports filed by American soldiers had been altered to make the case against Omar. That's illegal, of course. At one point, Canadian officials went to Guantanamo to try and trick Omar into incriminating himself. They deprived him of sleep for 3 weeks, and then they interrogated him for 4 days. They did this knowing that the death penalty was a real possibility if they succeeded. Once again, this is highly illegal. The Supreme Court of Canada has said so. Then there's the whole matter of whether or not any enemy soldier can be charged with murder in the context of a battle, let alone whether a child soldier could be charged. In 2006, after Omar had already been held for 4 years without trial, the Supreme Court of the United States ruled that the charges against Omar were not valid, and they threw them out. But Mr. Bush was president then, and he simply changed the laws and applied them retroactively to Omar. He charged the 15-year-old with war crimes, the first time ever that the United States has leveled such charges against a minor. Omar was placed in the same category as the Nazi camp commanders responsible for the execution of millions of innocent civilians. This, Mr. Edney told our students, is our post-9/11 world, and it's dangerous for all of us. Students listened with rapt attention. Omar was their age. He was Canadian. 13 other Western nations had had adult citizens detained by the Americans in this controversial prison, but each and every one of those nations had demanded and achieved the return of their citizens, all except Canada. The Canadian Supreme Court had spoken out against our government's treatment of Omar, as had the Canadian Council of Catholic Bishops, the United Church of Canada, not to mention the many human rights organizations that had labored tirelessly to negotiate a safe, lawful resolution to this difficult circumstance, both for Canadians and for Omar. Our students were not only riveted, but they were also distressed. When the conference ended on a note of hopelessness, my colleagues and I were concerned. Hopelessness, we felt, was not a pedagogically responsible place to leave our learning. At King's, we not only help students to see the world's complexity and pain, but we also prepare them to engage with it. Responsibility. It's about the ability to respond to the things that touch us in order that we not be left hopeless before them. It's the teacher's job to cultivate the ability to respond well. As I mentioned at the outset, King's, like Campion, is a liberal arts university anchored in the Christian intellectual tradition. In their most robust conception, the liberal arts are designed to train good citizens. The liberal arts are directed toward the intellectual and spiritual development of its students, so as to build the capacity to wade among the weeds of civil unrest and to pull from that slough of confusion and conflict a thoughtful plan, a way of being, a set of actions that direct community toward a greater good. In the wake of the 2008 conference, it was clear that we had work to do. Following the conference, my colleagues and I conferred briefly in the hallway, and afterwards I addressed the crowd from the main stage. I acknowledged to our students that they had just heard a disturbing presentation, and I encouraged them to go out and learn all they could about the Khadr case from as many different points of view as they were able to hear. I told them that they had just heard a single story from a powerful and persuasive advocate. If they were to assess the issues at stake in this story without the influence of any inordinate attachments, as St. Ignatius would counsel us to do, they would need to know more than the one story. As it happened, there were a series of conflicting stories being told about the Khadr case. We challenged students to do the work, to listen deeply to these other accounts. And then we told them that if, after they'd done this work, they were still upset by what they had learned, that they could come back. My fellow faculty members and I promised that we would not be hopeless. To be honest, when I set this challenge, I imagined that would be the end of it. Our interdisciplinary studies conference happens in the midst of a busy term. There would be no extra credit for the work I challenged my students to take on. If they did the work, it would be on their own time as a response to their own interest. I was amazed by what happened next. The following weeks are among the most exhilarating of my career. My colleagues and I watched with amazement as our students took up the challenge. They spoke to their members of parliament, to journalists who had researched the story, and to NGOs, non-governmental organizations, who had expert knowledge about the issue. They held viewings of the newly released CBC documentary, The US versus Omar Khadr. They wrote to the Prime Minister and they read the House of Commons proceedings about the case. And as they did this work, something really interesting began to happen. Their strong feelings began to generate positive energy. As they knew more, they were better able to listen to the many versions of the story that, in the first instance, had only caused frustration and hopelessness. They became increasingly sophisticated consumers of the points of view offered by those who held opinions about the case that ran directly contrary to those that they had learned at the outset. For example, as a result of their learning, students became adept at hearing the subtexts that underlie the rationales offered to them. They learned to discern the fundamental commitments that animated views from a variety of political positions. Whether conversation partners began with a tough on crime or a rule of law orientation, the underlying assumptions of each were laid bare. Who are we? Where are we? What's wrong? How do we fix it? What does the good look like? And what do we know to be true? The worldview questions bubbled to the surface of each conversation, and each speaker's selection and arrangement of relevant facts provided insight about his or her final commitments, commitments which the speakers themselves might be only nominally, if at all, aware. For our students, knowledge of the multiple stories worked as a sort of inoculation against the knee-jerk reaction of polarizing emotions. Clear thinking about a multiple of facts allowed them to tolerate the complexities of the situation. They not only understood the arguments offered to them by others, but they also learned to have a measure of compassion for those whose emotional responses on any side of the issue served to truncate, to limit the range of considerations that they could tolerate. For example, students pondered, is the application of the rule of law in the Khadr case a slap in the face to our Canadian military personnel? A US soldier died the day that Omar was wounded. Many wanted to make the argument. Our students learned to see the larger picture. Supporting and upholding the rule of law and its application to all citizens is the least we can do to support those who risk their lives to preserve this freedom. Is support for the fair application of the law in the Khadr case an act of disrespect for the Conservative Party of Canada? It appeared that this was exactly what certain stakeholders wanted to believe. But for all the tough on crime emphasis placed by the last Conservative administration, a more complete understanding of the historic values of that party allowed students to see how the rule of law had been and still is central to that party's core values. By way of their deep, full understanding of the situation, students not only learned to see what was wrong, to think critically about the issues, but they could also begin to formulate a vision for how things could be right. In late October of 2008, students returned to my office with a plan. They had learned, and they wanted to share what they had learned. They were convinced that if their fellow Canadians could only know what they knew, everything would change. While good learning practices allowed students to critique the situation, It was an act of imagination that allowed them to marshal all of their carefully arranged facts into a vision of the future that might address the concerns of all that they had met during their research. That ability to envision a positive, alternative future directed students' actions in two key directions. They wanted to share with other Canadians what they had learned, and they wanted to reach out to Omar himself. So, in November of 2008, they organized a version of their interdisciplinary studies conference for the city of Edmonton. 700 Edmontonians and representatives from several national media outlets came to a downtown concert hall to hear and report on the story that our students told. Another smaller group of students, following a call discerned from Matthew 25, enjoining followers of Christ to visit the prisoner, began a correspondence with Omar by way of letters exchanged through Mr. Edney. A year later, in November of 2009, the King students collaborated with their peers at the Al Rashid Mosque and the University of Alberta students to stage an outdoor rally that once again garnered national media attention. Last but not least, students collaborated on an information brochure that was distributed to members of Parliament. What began as a distinctively Christian meditation on the issues of national importance soon became an interfaith, intercommunity learning and sharing opportunity. As they worked on these projects, students were renewed in their energies as they moved outside of their studies to engage their community. Their capacity to hear and understand those alternative points of view allowed them to work across the dividing lines to build common purpose with others. Ad hoc meetings, planning sessions arose all over campus and continued throughout that two-year period. Finally, faculty and students talked about how to communicate issues in respectful terms. For example, we talked about the need to understand our material well and to express ourselves clearly with the media. We practiced addressing people who were vehemently opposed to the work with courtesy and respect. We worked with local police to ensure that our public events were well planned, that there would be no surprises for our local law enforcement teams. We modeled transparency in our writing to Omar, writing that we knew would be read by his American military captors. I wrote letters to Omar too. Before long, I was asked if my letters could become lessons. Omar's discussions with King's students rekindled within him his own desire to study. So I drafted makeshift correspondence lessons in English lit. Throughout this period and throughout all of the activities, the students and I both fought and felt our way through the uncertainties. We prayed for the strength and the time to do the next right thing. And believe me, that was hard. As I said at the outset, all of this doing, all of these extra activities were happening both for me and my students on top of everything else we had going. Studies, teaching, family, all of it needed its usual attention. All of this other stuff happened between the cracks in the evenings, on the weekends. Looking back, it's a miracle that any of it happened. A miracle that we were all standing at the end of what became a two-year block of time. In May of 2010, the students who had been most active on the Khadr case graduated. In many respects, my teacherly work was complete, or so I thought. In October of 2010, Omar signed a plea deal with the U.S. military court. because of my school correspondence with him, those makeshift lessons I had included in my letters, I was asked to speak during a mitigation hearing that preceded Omar's sentencing at that Guantanamo Bay tribunal. So what does an English professor say to a Guantanamo military tribunal? I spoke of the young man's educational potential, and I discussed his character. I argued that the members of the jury who would choose Omar's fate were in the same position that my lit students find themselves in when they assess characters in a novel. These members of the jury had never met Omar. They'd only read about him. He was like a protagonist in a literary work where they were asked to evaluate. So I talked about what it means to read with intelligent charity. How we assess narrators, the reliable ones and the not so reliable ones. How we ask questions about plot and setting and tone. I talked about the duty and responsibility of a court rooted in a Christian tradition where truth must be reconciled with peace and justice with mercy. Following the trial, the Defense Counsel of the U.S. military asked if my colleagues and me, if my colleagues and I could devise an educational curriculum to carry Omar through the final year of solitary confinement that would follow his sentencing. Unlike prisons in the United States and Canada, there were no provisions for education in Guantanamo, not even for a teenager. And so we did. We developed a course of study that could work in the unusual circumstance where teachers could not speak directly with their student. We designed a series of lectures around Canadian novels, books about home for a young man who longed to return. We addressed his need for remedial instruction in essay writing and basic math, but we ensured that the content was pitched to interest his very agile and intelligent adult mind. We crafted lessons that would have some chance of working when they were taught by the military defense lawyers who worked on Omar's case. The lawyers had offered to become teachers, our surrogates, in order to help prepare Omar for his return to Canada and to help him pass his last year in Guantanamo more profitably than the earlier ones had been. Although that plea deal stipulated that Omar would spend only one more year in Guantanamo, his transfer to Canada was stalled for another 11 months. So in the spring of 2012, the US military invited me to visit with Omar in Guantanamo. In April, and then again in May, I conducted summer session in that most unusual teaching environment, where I met a competent, diligent, and grateful student. Finally, on Saturday, September 29th, 2012, 10 years, 2 months, and 2 days after his capture, Omar finally returned home to the Canadian prison system. He was placed at the maximum security facility in Millhaven, Ontario. On May 28th of 2013, at his own request, Omar moved from Ontario to a maximum security prison in Edmonton. The prison administration welcomed my colleagues and me as volunteers, and we continued to teach Omar in person 3 days a week. This arrangement continued beyond February 7th, 2014, when, after his security classification was changed from maximum to medium and eventually minimum, he was moved to Bowdoin Institution, a prison 2 hours south of Edmonton. When, on May the 7th, 2015, Omar was released on bail, his teachers continued to work with him throughout the following summer. And in September of 2015, exactly 7 years, a jubilee, 7 years after the community at King's had first heard his story, Omar Khadr became an official King's student. The seven-year journey from 2008 to 2015 began with a process of discernment, of expanding the repertoire of stories available about this issue. Through a process of respectful listening and critical thinking, the community discerned the core issues at stake. And the journey ended when Omar attended our interdisciplinary studies conference in September of 2015. By blending our theory with our practice, students and faculty struggle to chart a path of ethical, sustainable, and appropriate engagement. It was a process that began with an intention to forestall hopelessness. So what about hope? What did my students and I learn about that most elusive and desirable state of being? Well, our intellects, our capacity for reason, played a large role in generating and sustaining hope. This, I believe, is the gift offered by the liberal arts. Hope was birthed out of the willingness to learn deeply, to engage, and to discern. It was enriched by the intellectual efforts to assess how the various stories could be traced back to final commitments about the public good that we either could or could not affirm. But once having critically engaged the facts, imagination was also required to move from that initial state of hopelessness into a vision of how things could be different. So much of what we do in the university context is about gathering facts, about a thoughtful assessment of how things go wrong. And I admit, this is an invaluable contribution to our public life. But I believe that this experience teaches that it's not enough. The community at the King's needed to know not only what was wrong, but it also needed to envision how things might be fixed, and fixed to the satisfaction of most stakeholders. This required an act of imagination. In his classic study about hope and the imagination, Jesuit scholar William F. Lynch observed the critical role of imagination in the pursuit of hope. The healing imagination must, he argued, find a way through fantasy and lies into fact and existence. It must create perspective for the facts that it has found and refuse to leave facts as scattered absolutes to preoccupy and to frighten human beings. Like hope itself, it will always suppose that there's a fact and a possibility that is not yet in. The imagination will always be the enemy of the absolutizing instinct and the ally of hope. Apart from that initial challenge to learn more, all of the activities that ensued, from the rallies to the letters, arose directly out of our students' own imaginations. They envisioned a hopeful ending for the Canadian people and for Omar, and they formulated plans that they could enact, that would allow them to take one tiny step in the right direction. Tell people what you've learned. Write the prisoner a letter. Students knew what they wanted to do. It remained to faculty to support them in doing these things well and in a spirit that reflected the core commitments of the King's community. And as our learning coupled with our theories and resolved itself in concrete practices, students moved from an emotional state of hopelessness into an energized experience of hope. In many respects, hope became for us an expression of trust. And a little Bunyan anecdote here, as I read Bunyan's Meditations on Hope, he talks about this relationship between hope and trust, so it's evidently something that the Christian tradition already knows. Both the students and later the faculty who worked toward a hopeful ending in Omar Khadr's story did so in the stubborn trust that whatever small, insignificant things we could do might somehow make a positive difference. If we had needed to know at the outset how these small gestures might make a difference, we would have given up before we even began. There was no clear path to connect letter writing, rallies, and lessons with Omar's safe return back to Canada or to his release. None of these activities had any direct effect at all. It was the lawyer's work, the government's actions, the court's decisions that eventually brought Omar home and set him free on bail. And yet, the activities undertaken by the King's community were important all the same. They connected Omar to extended community. They provided him with a place to belong, a place where he could learn. At this hour, when the value of the liberal arts faces challenges on all sides, and when our civil sphere is in a state of unrest, these are, I believe, deeply significant things. I am privileged to have been able to share with you a story that underscores the value of places like Campion College and the King's University. In the real and necessary pressure to prepare our students for employment, let us not forget the value of preparing them for life. In the haste to ensure their critical acumen, let us not forget to teach them how to dream. For these are, my friends, the practices that allow us to discern and to cultivate hope. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much for a talk full of hope and inspiration, very definitely. We do have time for some questions, which hopefully will be short questions in the sense of then we can get through more of them. So you can either, if you have a strong voice, we can take some questions, or there are some microphones, which I presume are working. I haven't actually checked those. We'll sort of have, if the speaker is happy, 10 minutes or so of questions. So yes, if you can keep your questions brief and yell so we can all hear, or use the microphones, and that'll be perfect.
Back to you. So I hear you asking where that group of students, that cohort of students is now, and whether or not they're doing social justice work. Yes, excellent question. You know, I mean, the sad truth is that I'm not in touch with each and every one of them. There was probably a really animated group of about 40, and they've scattered to the winds. But I can say many of them have indeed gone on to political activity, serving in all three of our major federal parties in significant positions. There are several of them, I can think right off the top, who've gone into the civil service in the province of Alberta. A couple of others who are rock stars, you know, cutting albums and traveling around the states and Canada. So yes, I think for many of them, it was indeed a moment where they came into adulthood in a very important way, and that learning has borne fruit in the employment that they've sought post-graduation.
I have seen any number of student groups get started, and the attrition rate is usually fairly high. How many of the students that were in that initial cohort remained in the project, and did you have to do anything special for the students who, for whatever reason, did not stay in it?
So it's absolutely true that that very large group that began with all sorts of activities in 2008 for the next number of months winnowed down. So there, like I say, there was probably about 40 that by the time graduation came still maintained an interest and, had some sort of role, I guess, in continuing to monitor those activities. There were many who dropped off for a variety of reasons. One, who has a special place in my heart, it became just too sad, right? And, I mean, the joy in my heart in knowing that that young woman now has seen the successful conclusion and that searing pain that she felt early on has been replaced by a sense of, happy resolution. But no, there were no formal structures to do anything in particular. For those of us, I mean, when I talk about my students, I do, it's like they're my children. But the fact of the matter was that I was serving and still do serve as Dean of Arts. So these were not, in fact, the group that were most animated, I had never met. They were not English students or English majors. Any of the activities that went on the part of faculty and administration were directly linked to what students were either needing or asking of us. And apart from the informal conversations that might be requested of us, no other activities. Yes, he lives nearby, and we continue to have a very, strong friendship. The Edney family, of course, is in Edmonton too, and that bond is very tight. You may have read that he had major surgery to repair that shoulder blade that was destroyed in 2002, and so he's at home with the Edneys recovering. But yes, we see each other very regularly. I'll go home to drive him to school next week. That'll be my assignment.
The title of your lecture is A Liberal Arts University's Journey with Omar Khadr. And a lot of the focus was on the impact, how Omar's situation influenced the Liberal Arts University, how it influenced the students at this university.
Right.
I'm wondering a little bit about the flip side. Mm-hmm. How did the works of those within that community and what they did for Omar, how has his understanding of the world evolved over the period of time in which King's was having an influence on him?
Right. Well, of course, that's a story we have to wait to hear Omar tell. you know, he is a very thoughtful young man. And right now he is in high gear working to get the education he's going to need to serve in the world. And he has a heart for nursing in particular. That's his dream. And so he's very focused and doing exceptionally well, if I may brag, an honor student. He hasn't, to my knowledge, done a lot of journaling or reflective work on just the questions that you're posing. I mean, naturally, he expresses very readily. He's very attached to the King's community. He has a special feeling for the place. And so even though he's off now at McEwen University doing some upgrading, he's taking a night course at King's just because that's where he likes to be. And that's lovely. But we'll have to wait. We'll have to wait and hear from him about, you know, what that meant on his side. He expresses, of course, very deep gratitude. Mm-hmm.
Every college and university in Canada to include issues of social justice alongside regular academic curriculum to make our society a more open one?
That's a lovely question. You know, I prize our interdisciplinary studies conferences. I think they are one of the most remarkable aspects of life at King's University. And what I prize most about them is that capacity to connect all of our disciplinary learning with real world issues. So, you know, twice a year we do it, shut down those regular classes, come together in a real grown-up academic conference. Our first year students, I will confess to you, hate it and don't know what's going on, and we have to work with them to try and, you know, figure it all out. By the time they get to their third and fourth year, you know, they're starting to appreciate it, and by the time they graduate, they come back, you know, from their work lives, and they bring their parents in many instances because they now appreciate and understand how that opportunity to connect what's happening in the real world with the ways of knowing that we cultivate in that liberal arts environment, how those things come together to give us a few hot tips about how to make a difference. Yeah, so I would highly recommend that. I mean, I'm on a little, you know, cross Canada, celebration routine or what, cheerleading, there we go, cheerleading exercise about the liberal arts. I think we have something exquisitely valuable, and our colleagues who work in the STEM area, science, technology, engineering, and math, they've done a beautiful job of linking themselves very tangibly with industry and the ways in which those disciplines serve. I think it's up to those of us who serve in liberal arts and sciences, social sciences, natural sciences, arts, to engage and cultivate those good habits that have us thinking about what it means to be a good citizen. Yeah, it's Canada's 150th, so let's get behind it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. Well, and you know, as I said at the outset, that's exactly what the students, that was their ambition, right? If they only knew what we knew, everything would change. And so with that energy and zeal that comes with a 20-something, you know, sensibility, out they went. And I think certainly what we can say is that they were very effective communicators. They garnered very quickly a reputation for being able to speak intelligently about the case. And so whenever something would bubble to the surface in the news, you know, we had to actually develop protocols for dealing with media on campus because it became a regular thing that people would want to come and poll our students, ask them questions. But I think in fairness, you know, it would be up to the members of parliament or up to you know, community groups who might have sensed the shift in their being as a result of exposure to the stories that our students told, to help us understand, you know, what the result of that is. We'd have to, you know, we'd have to do a good empirically verifiable sociological study, yes, to try and make that assertion. Mm-hmm. Thank you for having me. Yeah. Well, there were certainly challenging moments, and it's important to say that not everybody was enthused, right? So there were students at King's who felt deeply annoyed by the activities of their colleagues who were engaged in what we'll call the campaign around the Khadr case. And it was our duty and responsibility to nurture and cultivate their voice, right? To exhort them to speak out and into student papers and whatever. It's absolutely true that there were members of our extended King's community whose eyebrows were raised over the position that our students and faculty had articulated on this issue. But I would say that particularly our faith community and certainly our student body grew tremendously over this period of engagement. 2 years is a very long time out of a community's life. And there were opportunities along the way to go out and talk to different constituencies. You know, I mean, I personally have made it, and I continue to do a policy that whenever a church group would ask me to speak about this issue, then I needed to make time. That's one of my calls. Members of our teaching team would go out with our community recruiters, the people who are involved in our organization, in speaking to our fundraisers, in relationships with some of our church support groups, and you know, it was their duty and responsibility to cultivate the conversation and to respond respectfully and truthfully to the questions that were raised there. So, you know, I would say we all grew together. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I would say, and maybe the last little point there, that common narrative, right, the for our Christian constituency, and I would say, of course, with the Muslim community too, the shared understanding in the broadest possible sense of the Abrahamic faith, and certainly the particular understanding of what our duties and responsibilities look like as Christians, who are sometimes called to suffer, right? Not all Skittles and beer, as my grandmother would say. Sometimes we're called into tough places. That narrative helped then to create understanding.
Firstly, thank you again. It's been extremely fruitful. My question is regarding the approach that was taken in this endeavor seemed to be rooted a lot in Christianity and having that Jesuit college. And dealing with, you know, going through the liberal arts, where there's this sort of implicit sentiment that, well, there is no truth with a capital T, or there is, you know, or there is no meaning after all, or different notions like that that come about. How would a student of faith, or coming from any tradition with a solid epistemology that says, well, this is how it is, or how do you either reconcile these things or deal with it, or have this difference add any value to your life going through that liberal arts education?
Okay. So the first thing, we want to say that our liberal arts thinking is predicated upon foundational, what I'll call axiomatic assumptions. And by axiomatic, I mean it in the mathematical understanding of the term, that these are assertions that we have to take on faith. In order to move forward, we make a proclamation, You know, on this ground I stand, and forward we go. So in a Christian liberal arts context, in a Muslim liberal arts context, in, you know, Jewish, Muslim or Jewish liberal arts context, there are any number of philosophical positions and religious positions that would not affirm your opening statement, which is to say there is no truth. In fact, what we would articulate instead is there is indeed capital T truth. And we are scared silly when we hear somebody say that they own it. But what we know to be true as a tenet of that faith, that we can move closer to it or move further away. And that's a very different starting position than the assumption that there is no truth. So I think, you know, in response to your excellent question, I would say the liberal arts tradition encompasses a vast set of philosophical starting points, right? Religious starting points that orient in the direction of a worship of the divine, philosophical starting points that don't necessarily, all of them engage in a very important way, the vision of the good. A vision of how we understand ourselves and our world. And so, you know, the richness in your liberal arts opportunity is that you get to sample those ideas, right? You can try out the various positions and work through with the guidance of those who are well-schooled in those philosophical and religious traditions, what the outcomes of those assumptions look like, and then to find where you belong. Mm-hmm. Yes.
What's next?
Oh, well, one of the most unexpected and joyful results of this work with the Khadr case and with Omar himself is that when the teaching team arrived on the campus at the Edmonton Maximum Security Prison, we weren't there a week before parole officers were meeting us in the hallway and saying, okay, who are you guys? And what are you doing? And have I got a student for you? Right? And so now, 3 years down the line, we have this lovely, teeny tiny initiative where we're up on that prison campus, dealing with a handful, I think there's 8 or 9 guys, who are working with us on liberal arts studies. So, you know, we're now in the process of formalizing a little bit. We offer to begin a non-credit course to evaluate seriousness of purpose in our prospective students and to give them the opportunity to remediate whatever core skills they're going to need for math or literacy. And then once they've completed that first course and demonstrated their capacities, and let me tell you, boy, oh boy, there's some gifted students. We then offer them the opportunity to study for accredited course. So we've worked out a credit arrangement with my home institution at King's University, which is, as I've said, confessionally Christian, so we're all about integrating faith and learning. But we've also then, you know, expanded. Many of the guys at the Max are not necessarily interested in the selection of courses that we would have at King's. One wanted to study law. And so what we did there then was arrange for a correspondence course with Athabasca University, and we came in and did the work as tutors to make that course possible. So that's the next thing. We're in the process of formalizing that. We're, you know, coming up with a funding umbrella, which, you know, when we hit our pot of gold, we're going to be in touch with Jason, who's going to do great things here. We're imagining that here in Canada we can do what our colleagues in the United States have done in you know, far less hospitable circumstances, to create a robust opportunity for post-secondary studies among the small cohort of federal inmates who would be eligible for that work. Mm-hmm. Good.
Thank you very much to our speaker one more time, and thank you all for showing up on a somewhat crisp spring evening, and thank you very much, and we hope to see you again. Bye now.